This is Philip Barnett with Amara of SLC Dunk. We've tried this a billion times, and I think it's finally working this time. How are you doing?
Doing great, man. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine. So tonight we have a epic battle between two of the bottom dwellers of the Western Conference and the Jazz and the Lakers. What are you looking forward to the most tonight?
I'm a little bit disappointed because I want to say that I felt like the Lakers were going to be a playoff team this year. So I'm going to look for the guys who are playing well. I'm looking for your young big Sakura. I also like Jordan Hill. I want to see what they do against the Jazz's young guys of Favors and Cantor. It's kind of a measuring stick. There's no way that we can compete with your three-point shooting, so I just want to see what happens in the paint.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's going to be an interesting matchup as well. I mean, if you look at the numbers, the Jazz haven't rebounded as well as a lot of people expected them to this year with their younger bigs. But a guy that, you know, that I like a lot, Jeremy Evans, he's been able to come off the bench and rebound at a pretty high rate. What do you think the Jazz have to do tonight to, you know, battle the Lakers' bigs on the boards?
I think they need to have consistent energy and consistent effort. In some of the games, they feel like, oh, well, we're more talented than this other team, which is, you know, we're the Jazz. We have, like, the lowest points scored. Like, we're the worst offense and the worst defense. So I don't know why some of these guys come with that attitude, but especially, it's not just the younger guys. It's also some of the veterans in contract years. They don't put in the effort every single day. The only one who's really doing that is Richard Jefferson, and that's sad when that's your best, you know, most consistent player. Yeah. Like, maybe that's okay in 1996 or whatever, but, yeah. So tonight, I want to see the bigs. They want to try. Like, Favors needs to stay out of foul trouble and play defense. Cantor, he's been, like, the missing man this year. I don't know what his problem is. Like, maybe his pet goldfish died or something, but he's got to start playing a little bit better. He was a number three pick. If you're a number three pick and you're coming off the bench in your third year, you know, maybe you were drafted by Michael Jordan, but I don't know.
Yeah, well, I mean, the Lakers they have a lot of lottery picks who haven't exactly panned out on the team this year. We got Wes Johnson, Xavier Henry, picked up, it's the kid, Kendall Marshall from the Suns last year.
Right,
You know, it's just a slew of lottery players in this game who haven't been exactly what, you know, the teams who drafted them expected them to be. On the perimeter, you guys have Trey Burke this year who's been playing far above what I expected him to be this year. You want to talk a little bit about why he's been able to be successful?
I think the main thing about Trey Burke is that he's always had this confidence about him back when he was a high school player. You know, his dad was his coach, and at Michigan, they did everything to make sure that the offense worked with him with the ball in the hands. It's not like he sat in his first year at Michigan. He started his first year. And while he did start behind freaking John Lucas III this year in Utah, that's just Utah being Utah. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, his confidence has not been shaken. Some of the other younger guys who are with the Jazz, they would start one game and then get a, you know, DNP CD the next game. Mm-hmm. And with Trey Burke, especially for a young guard, a lead guard, he's a guy who shoots more than he passes. It's got to be confidence. And that's why he's been successful so far. And that's exactly what this team needs, is some guy who wants the ball in his hand when they need to score, instead of these guys who are like, well, you know, I just rebound. I don't know anything. So,
Yeah. And then another guy who's been playing particularly well this year is Gordon Hayward. And that's he's going to be in a matchup that I'm very interested in against Wes Johnson, who's been very, very cold from three this year. Well, I mean, in recent weeks, he hasn't shot the ball well, but he's been very good defensively, and he's been the Lakers' best perimeter defender this year. So what do you think Hayward can do, you know, to kind of find his rhythm against Wes? And, I mean, he's going to have to play well if they're going to beat the Lakers tonight. So, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
Well, they were in the same draft class, so I think for some level these guys are always going to be kind of connected. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe they're not at that Paul George level, but it's going to be pretty good. They're both very underrated athletically. Wes Johnson came out as a more demonstrative player with his athleticism. I think Gordon Hayward is a little bit sneaky there. But what Gordon has to do to get going early on in this game is that he's got to get some easy shots. And that means playing off the ball. Mm-hmm. And that wasn't a possibility early on in the season where there were no point guards playing for the Jazz and Hayward had to play more pick and roll. That's not necessarily his strength. And against the Lakers, that's not going to work. So if they can get Wesley Johnson a little bit tangled up with some of the screens that they have coming at him, Hayward may be able to get a few mid-range jumpers, but that's actually the worst efficiency shot in the league. So if that's the Jazz offense, then I don't really... I'm not surprised where they're the worst offense in the league. So.
Yeah, well, I mean, speaking of point guards, the Lakers are struggling in that department as well. Two of our three guys are injured for at least the next 5 weeks. Steve Nash, we have no idea when he's going to come back. And if he does come back, we don't know if he's going to be effective or not. So right now it's Jordan, Farmar, and then Nick Young, Xavier Henry, Pau Gasol, whoever wants to handle the ball, I guess. Against the Heat, the Heat started extending their defense a little bit when Jordan Farmar wasn't on the ball in the game before that. I can't remember who it was, but they started trapping in the backcourt. Yeah, the Suns. Yeah, they started trapping in the backcourt and got the Lakers ball handlers in trouble. Do you see the Jazz being able to do something like that to, you know, extend their defense and try to get the Lakers ball handlers in trouble since they're so thin in that area?
No, and this falls onto the head coaches. The Jazz never try and take advantage of the disadvantages of the other team. Mm-hmm. Even I think it was like 2 years ago, the Lakers were playing their third game in three nights during the lockout year.
Yeah.
And the Utah Jazz had never played a game that season yet. So they were absolutely on the opposite spectrums of health and conditioning. Utah didn't run. Mm-hmm. You'd think that would be when they would run. Like, okay, so the Lakers are kind of hurting at point guard this year. This would be the time to trap them? No, because Tyron Corbin is so focused on getting the defensive rebounding percentage back up. So he's going to have everyone crash the paint, which means running back on defense, not necessarily trying to counterattack. It's Ty's game, man. He takes what the defense gives him, and he takes what the offense gives him, too. He doesn't force anything. So I think the Lakers will definitely have the advantage there. Your point guards will still have enough room to work around.
Yeah, and then lastly, one of the other guys who I've been a little bit impressed with this year when I've been watching is Alec Burks. Last year, he wasn't particularly impressive, and I don't think he found a lot of playing time with Mo Williams over there. But this year, it seems like he's kind of found a little bit more of a rhythm. And he's going to be coming off the bench against the Lakers' second unit, which has been very good this year. Do you think he can find some success against the Lakers' second unit this year?
I think it's going to be hard to tell because he is very volatile. Some days he's really good, some days he's not good. And I guess that's why he's not necessarily NBA starter material, because he's not consistent every game. He is better when he's going to the basket. If the Lakers, and this has been the case for the last 8 years at least, the Lakers have really good length, and that can be frustrating on defense. If he doesn't feel the need to drive, and if he settles for jumpers, then he's not going to have a good night.
Okay.
Because he's not a good shooter like those, you know, Crawford types who play for the Clippers, who are just able to get hot off the bench. You know, he's a guy who needs to get going. So against this Lakers team, against this Lakers bench, maybe. But I think that depends more on what he's thinking at that moment. So he's a big mystery.
Okay. So tonight, 7:30 Pacific time, Lakers Jazz. You have any predictions for tonight's game?
I think the Lakers are going to give the Jazz probably more than they can handle. And I'm particularly interested to see the Lakers, if they're going to play their like younger guys together, because Utah's supposed to be the team that's all about their youth. But I'm actually worried about like a Henry Farmar. He's not necessarily young. Kendall Marshall, Wesley Johnson, those guys, they've been in the league for a little bit, and I think that they're better than our guys.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where it ends. I think the Lakers are going to get a road win tonight.
Okay. All right. Thanks, Amar. Thanks. Looking forward to tonight's game. Hopefully we get a good one. It's not some sort of blowout either way. But, you know, enjoy the game tonight. Thanks for coming on.
Thanks a lot for having me. And go Jazz, go Lakers.